Today, on August 15th, India is celebrating 75 years of independence. Before we move on to the event, during this Platinum Jubilee celebration of Independence Day, let us start off with prayer by Sukhila Srihari, who is doing MSc Maths in Pondicherry University, and Suyajna Srihari, who is doing BSc Honors Mathematics from Brennan College, Kannur University.
सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहे तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्युषावहे ॐ शान्ति 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 वन्दे मातरम् वन्दे मातरम् सुजला सुफला मलयज शीतला सस्य श्यामला मादरम् वन्दे मादरम् शुभ्र ज्योत्स्ना पुलकितयामिनी कुसुमित द्रुमदल शोभिनी सुहासिनी सुमधुर भाषिणी सुगदां वरदां मातरम् वन्दे मातरम् वन्दे मातरम्
Now, today we are gathered here for the invited talk on Beauty of Complex Analysis by Dr. Ambit Vijay Kumar. Sir, I wholeheartedly welcome you. Today's event is being organized by the WhatsApp group Math Aspirants, which was created by Dr. Vinod Kumar P. Let me give a brief introduction about him. He is an assistant professor from Tunchan Memorial Government College, Tirur, Kerala. During this pandemic time, he has taken a lot of initiative to motivate students to prepare for competitive exams. The WhatsApp group was created in 2017, namely Math Aspirants, a good platform to discuss mathematics. Through this WhatsApp group, there were online classes scheduled, online exams which were conducted through Google Forms, and which has helped students tremendously without any financial aid. And as a result to this, many students have gotten admissions in TIFR, NITs, and IITs. The students who were once a member of this WhatsApp group are research scholars now and are helping other students as resource persons. So what once had been started as a WhatsApp group is now slowly becoming a mathematics community. I would like to call Vinod Kumar sir to give to talk about a few words.
Dear friends, a warm good morning and Independence Day greetings to all. I am very happy to see that Math Aspirants WhatsApp groups initiated by myself in 2017 is now emerged as an active platform for math students and scholars community across India. Apart from the problem discussions in the groups, our initiatives includes organizing national webinars, online problem solving sessions, and online test series. I'm very pleased on knowing that these programs helped math student community a lot, especially on this pandemic situation, where their regular education has faced many challenges and obstacles. In these years, many of our members succeeded in getting admission to PG and PhD programs at several premier institutions across India. I take this opportunity to thank all my teachers, well-wishers, supporters, and the group members for their supports and blessings on my way. Math Aspirants is a unity of math lovers, and our policy is to spread mathematics via sharing. Today, we are blessed to have an expert talk on the beauty of complex analysis by Dr. Ambat Vijay Kumar, Emeritus Professor, Cochin University of Science and Technology, Kerala, and Vice President of Ramanujan Mathematical Society, India. I express my sincere gratitude to him for being with us. Also, I express my love and gratitude to Dr. Bijimon R., Ms. Sukala and Suyatna Srihari, Ms. Gia Rose Johnson, Ms. Anne-Mary Tony, Ms. Namrata, and Ms. Amrita Warrier for their support in organizing this event. I hope that the session ahead will be really fruitful for all who loves mathematics. Thank you.
Now, today we are here to attend the talk on beauty of complex analysis by Dr. Ambat Vijay Kumar. I would like to give a brief introduction about today's speaker. Dr. Ambat Vijay Kumar has done his MSc from University of Cochin from 1978 to 1980 and PhD from Cochin University of Science and Technology in 1986. He is a fellow of the Institution of Combinatorics and its Applications, Canada, since 1999. His area of research is graph and networks. He is the regional coordinator of Mathematical Olympiad from 1990 to 2017. Consultant of Malayalam translation published by Kerala Language Institute in 2012 of the book The Man Who Knew Infinity. He is actively involved in math popularization, writes popular articles in Malayalam and English on various aspects of mathematics mainly aimed at students. He has traveled widely to Hungary, Italy, South Korea, Spain, Taiwan, Germany, Czech Republic, and Slovenia, and many more to give talks. He has interviewed the former president, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, and also has interacted with the Professor C.R. Rao. He is mentor of INSPIRE program of DSTGOI, vice president of Ramanujan Mathematical Society, and emeritus professor in QSAT since 2018. Sir, I welcome you once again. We are fortunate to attend the talk on this auspicious day. So, on behalf of Math Aspirants WhatsApp group and all the participants of today's webinar, I extend a warm welcome to you, sir. I also welcome Dr. Vinod Kumar T, who truly is an inspiration to students and without whom this event was not possible. I would like to welcome Dr. Bijuman R, Professor of Mathematics in Mahatma Gandhi College, Irati, Kannur, Kerala, who has helped us a lot with his technical support. And last but not the least, I extend my hearty welcome to all the participants of today's event. Now, I would like to call today's speaker to take over the session.
Okay, thank you very much. Very good morning to all of you. Sahana vavatu, sahanau bhunaktu, sahaviryam karavavahai. Tejasvi navadhi tamastu, ma vidyushavahai. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. That's a quote from Ishavasya Upanishad, which is also in the logo of Cochin University. Sahaviryam karavavahai means let tejasvi navadhi tamastu, let the knowledge benefit both the teacher and the taught. So that's an apt word to start any academic program. Before I start presentation, it's a free session in the sense that whenever you want to ask, am I audible? Is it audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. If you find any interruption, please call me. Vinod can do that.
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
So I've been involved with talent search, mathematics popularization since many, many years, maybe at least since my MSc days. That was the training that I got from my university, Cochin University. And the Cochin University was thankful to me in the sense that I should be thankful to the Cochin University for extending my service informally in the form of emeritus professor for next 3 years, so 5 years. So I am close to my university, both in both physically and mentally. So I am a product of Cochin University. I am proud to say that there was no UGC entrance test or admission test net like that when I completed my MSc in 80. I just shared this with Dr. Bijimon now. My scholarship was 300 rupees. Yeah. So is it a raised hand or by chance? Okay. Fine. So that is the situation. The topic that I am going to discuss is beauty of complex analysis, a subject which is very, very close to my heart. It was my first love. Complex analysis was my first love, but I couldn't marry complex analysis because it was told during 80s that it is all saturated. We don't have interesting or easy problems or even moderate difficult problems to start and get a PhD degree. So though I got admitted to Delhi University, Delhi IIT and Chennai IIT, I will talk about that Chennai IIT thing a bit later. I was offered only operation research. That was a very hot subject in 1980s. But I being an ardent lover of complex analysis, I said, no chance, I will take only in complex analysis, but I couldn't do in complex analysis also. So I did something on discrete and then finally switched to graph theory where I am reasonably comfortable. Okay, so this is my background and I come from a very, very, very rural place. I didn't know to speak English at all, but all that was done by a person whom I am going to show later. That is the person behind the behind everything rather. So I'm going to formally share the screen. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I will, as a teacher, I'm a bad teacher in the sense that I will ask some questions during my talk. We can give answer immediately in the chat box. We will not give time because of technology's intervention. So whoever gets maximum points that will be monitored by our group, they will be given some gift. They will be sent some book gift. So first of all, let me congratulate and thank Vinod Kumar and Bijimon and his team. They have brought in several young students, energetic students like Anne-Marie, Jia, Rahul Rajan, and my good old friend Nias also has joined. Lot of my former students have joined, and I'm happy that Vinod Kumar and Bijimon could bring them together in a common forum. There, I think we have crossed about 250 participants. So with a salute to the Martis and all great leaders who was responsible for our country being independent, we salute them on this happy 75th Independence Day. Okay. I start with a quote. My first question is, whose words are this? I will give a tip that you never expect this quote from such a person, so be careful while answering. When, however, with much effort, I reached the 13th proposition of Euclid, the utter simplicity of the subject was suddenly revealed to me. A subject which only required a pure and simple use of one's reasoning powers could not be difficult. Ever since that time, geometry has been both easy and interesting for me. So that is a famous quote by a more famous person. I give a tip. You can start answering in the chat box. I will not check chat box now. I have asked some people to monitor the answers. Whoever writes maximum number of answers in this session will get a gift. If somebody wants to share their excitement immediately, you can unmute and immediately tell me if you have an answer. I can wait for a second. Anybody?
Sir Mahatma Gandhi.
Good. Who is that?
Sir Kana Bindal.
Pardon?
Sir Kana Bindal.
Where are you from?
Sir, I am from Agra.
Good. That's from Mahatma Gandhi, which you never expect in his famous book, My Experiments with Truth. Okay, fine. So I'll start the beauty of complex analysis. In fact, mathematics is beautiful, complex analysis, mathematics, therefore by transitivity, beauty of complex analysis follows, right? A implies B, B implies C, implies A implies C, if the relation is transitive. So the title could have been Beauty of Mathematics. I plan to, I'm immediately inspired by your participation, I'm going to make it as a series of lectures. There are certain subjects in mathematics which I can confidently talk and explain the beauty. So this will be called Beauty of Mathematics series number one. This is complex analysis. Thank you, Vinod Kumar and Vijayman, for inspiring me to start this session. So in this, we have two beautiful flowers, lotus and rose, and the beautiful campus of Cochin University with the excellent logo, Tejasvi Navati Tamastu. Okay. Somebody told that I am a fan of Dr. Kalam. Not only me, lakhs and lakhs, millions and millions of people all over the world is a fan of Dr. Kalam. I was fortunate enough to meet him, I will say at least seven times, face to face, nobody will be there. So that was one of the most happy occasion which changed my view for life. That was a turning point. So today I have taken the quotation, you cannot change your future, but you can change your habits. And surely your habits will change your future, definitely. Okay, so if somebody is getting up only at 8 o'clock, you start getting up at 7 o'clock next day, 6 o'clock. I don't say that you should not sleep at all. You should sleep for 8 hours and only 8 hours. If you don't like mathematics, okay, forget about mathematics. There are many other beautiful subjects. If you don't like complex analysis, okay, doesn't matter. There are some other subjects, but you should not ignore anything. Then you cannot do, you cannot reach anywhere. So beauty is at the eyes of the beholder. On the leftmost, somebody can answer whether you know them. This is the most beautiful structure in the world ever constructed. Anybody? Okay, I will not wait for more than a few seconds because there is a time constraint. This is the structure what is called the Parthenon in Greece, which is being rebuilt in 1975. The construction which follows the golden ratio, 1 + √5/2. This is supposed to be the most beautiful structure. And you know Wah Taj. Somebody told that everyone knows that is Taj Mahal. It's a memorial. I was fortunate enough to visit this. Anybody who has not done this, after Corona, you please go and visit Taj. Here you see the famous painting of Picasso, Pablo Picasso, what's called the box structure. That's also beautiful. So what beauty is there in complex analysis? Now come to the quote of Rabindranath Tagore, who is a famous poet as well as artist, painter, philosopher, teacher, whatnot. He says that anyone who has the knowledge has the responsibility to impart it to the students. Anyone who has the knowledge has the responsibility to impart it to the students. And whenever we give more education, we will get more. That's where the power law works. You give, I get more. There is no other phenomena where if I start giving, actually it reduces. But every time when I talk for a webinar, I prepare myself. I've been preparing for at least 1 week to make this presentation as much as you can. I can. And there is a famous quote by Swami Vivekananda who says that, never say no, never say I cannot. If you are four, you are infinite and all the power is within you, you can do anything. So I am concentrating this statement to you basically, and it's all depends on what you want to be. Vinod Kumar cannot create a mathematician. He cannot create a physicist. He cannot create a musician. neither Vijayamohan or Vijay Kumar or anybody. You have to decide what you have to become, and if you decide to become, you, nobody can stop you. There is a divine fire in you which will automatically catch. But we should not sit down and relax that, okay, God will take care of me. God is not a fool to take care of anybody who is lazy. Okay, so fine. I dedicate this lecture to two personalities. One is my guru, Professor Basir Hasan Abdi, who showed me the beauty of complex analysis about 40 years ago. He is no more, he passed away in 1999. Cochin University organizes his memorial lecture every year. And the other person is Professor P. Bhattacharya, who was professor of IIT Madras. I just knew one week ago that he passed away last year, 2020. And about Bhattacharya, I had told in a different forum in Math Aspirants, what did he do to me? I'll spend a minute to talk to him about him. Professor Bhattacharya was a professor at IIT Madras, expert in complex analysis. And I had applied for a research position, research scholar in IIT Madras, and he asked me, what do you know in complex analysis? I said, I know everything in complex analysis. That was age 21. After 40 years, I don't have that confidence to say that I know everything in complex analysis, because what we have seen is only part, a fraction of the beauty of complex analysis. But at that age, I was more confident to say that I know everything. And the interview continued for about 1.5 hours for PhD admission. Fortunately or unfortunately, I didn't get it. Then after that, we became very good friends, Bhattacharya and myself. We served in some forums, and I was very sad to know from my friend Professor Tamba Nair that Bhattacharya is no more. He passed away last year. So he tested my knowledge in complex analysis, and you can also test me. I'm happy to share my thoughts on complex analysis. So this is my university. Welcome to Cochin University. It is completing 50 years, golden jubilee year. Let us spend 1 minute about confidence building. See, the one problem with the students is that if they fail, of course, during these systems, we don't fail, but suppose we don't get the marks that you expected. Personally, I don't care for marks at all. I have seen, after teaching Cochin University for 30 years, very, very bright students with less marks, but they are genuinely excellent. So I don't have much weight for marks. Look at the story of Dr. Kalam. He was rejected in the interview of pilot and he became a missile man. Look at the story of Abraham Lincoln, the 16th president of USA, who was defeated, failed, lost, nervous problem, etc., etc., for about 30 years. And in 1860, he was elected the president of the most powerful country in the world, United States of America. So failure, he should be there to become successful. Then we can enjoy the beauty of success much more than the usual case. So let us slowly enter into the subject. So recorded history is about 5,000 years, but there are evidences that mathematics existed is 20,000 years ago. It's prehistoric. Babylonian, Egyptian, Greek, Roman, Chinese culture and Indian. Vedic period, not Vedic mathematics. And the Kerala school of mathematics from 1350 to 1650, where what is called the golden age of Indian mathematics due to the work of Madhava, Nilakantha and others in the Kerala Malappuram area. And the Islamic contribution, we have Hindu Arabic numerals 1, 2, 3, etc., 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. Invention of 0 by Brahmagupta and 4 basic operations. We have another numeral system called Abjad numeral system. That's where you have 7, 8, 6 in the Muslim mosque, which is the numerical equivalent of Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Let me cut an unexpected joke that my second language for pre-degree was Arabic. Okay, I know Quran and Hadith. Okay, I've studied, but I forgot because I don't talk Arabic. Right, so 7, 8, 6 is the numerical equivalent of just like our Katabayadi system in the Hindu system, we have abjad numeral system where there is a one-one correspondence between numbers and alphabets, a sort of cryptography. So when you write Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim and give numerical values to each alphabet and add up, what you get is 786. So I strongly recommend few books for reading. P.P. Divakaran, Professor of Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, The Mathematics of India, Concepts, Method and Connections is the most authentic book on Indian mathematics, followed by two classics of history, Men of Mathematics and Concise History of Mathematics. So we want to talk about the major classification. There are more than 30,000 subclassifications, 30,000. So major is continuous versus discrete, but now continuous and discrete. So calculus, differential equation, integration, analysis, real, complex, functional, mechanics, etc. So I will give you one bag to put all these things. At some one point of time, you may require another bag because, oh, you find something, you know, algebra is not analysis. Number theory, there is no analysis. So what is the basic force, basic thing which you change from, sorry, which you differentiate from analysis or calculus to number theory is that of the limit process. Limit process is not applicable in graph theory or combinatorics or coding theory or something like that. So if you start with, now from today onwards, you walk with two bags. Whatever new subject you hear, you put it in one box and the other one in the other box. And the two boxes are going to feel like anything. So I will start the game. I'll put calculus in one box, then somebody should put graph theory in the other box. Okay, so two boxes are there. Now you require at least three or four boxes. So if you ask Vicky, what is mathematics? There is an answer that it is study of topics such as quantity, structure, space, and change. And we will realize that mathematics can be something different, where we are not interested in structure or change. If there is change, there is a rate of change, that is dy by dx comes, d square over by dx square comes, etc. And there are plenty of mathematics where there is no dy by dx, there is no change required. Okay, and what Bertrand Russell, what is famous for Bertrand Russell is another question. Other than being a philosopher and mathematician, what is he famous for? Bertrand Russell, who said that, yeah, mathematics possesses not only truth, but supreme beauty, a beauty cold and austere like that of sculpture, such that only the greatest art can show. It's an art. And Paul Halmoche, a French mathematician, says that the only way to learn mathematics is to do mathematics. Mathematics is doing. I know Cauchy's theorem, but I don't know how to evaluate the integral. Then you are gone. Nobody wants you. So to learn mathematics, you have to do mathematics, and there is beauty in mathematics. Therefore, there is beauty in complex analysis also. So these are some books. What is Mathematics? 17 Equations That Changed the World, Ian Stewart. And the famous book is How to Solve It. If I ask you what is the most fundamental and exciting theorem that you have studied ever from school days, I am sure that most of you are going to vote for my own answer, that is Pythagoras theorem. In a right angle triangle, sum of squares of the sides is equal to square of the hypotenuse. And those integers satisfying x square plus y square equal to z square are called Pythagorean triplets. And it may be a surprise to at least some of you to know that this algebraic equation cannot be generalized. I don't want to tell about that more. Those who know it, keep the answer with you. I will ask you later. What is that? What is that enigma that Pythagoras' theorem is not true when n 2 is replaced by 3 or 4 or 5? In George Polya's How to Solve It, he has given four steps. First, you have to understand the problem. You read the problem carefully. Don't try to answer without understanding the question. What is the problem? Then give me the answer. After understanding, make a plan how to do that. carry out the plan. Look back on your work. How could it be bettered? So you have the picture of George Polya. If there is a problem you cannot solve, then there is an easier problem you can solve. Find it. So you please follow the principles of Polya's principle for solving problems. And somebody asked in 1988, which is the best equation that you come across. Then there was a survey. There was a tie for second place. The famous formula of Euler's polyhedral formula of a polyhedron, number of vertices minus number of edges plus number of faces is always 2. And the Euclid's theorem that there are infinite number of props. I think most of you will know the proof that there are infinite number of primes. Isn't it? But there is a proof of infinitude of primes using topology. Try to find it. Okay, I shall repeat. There is a proof that there are infinite number of primes using topological argument. But the first prize went to the magic equation of Euler, e raised to I pi plus 1 is equal to 0. E raised to I pi plus 1 is equal to 0 is fantastic. The most exciting equation in the whole of mathematics. Because 1 and 0 are integers, real numbers. You have E, I and pi, exponential E, I imaginary unit, and the, you know, pi, a very dangerous mathematical constant. And if you exponentiate e raised to I pi and add 1, you get 0 because e raised to I pi is cos pi plus I sine pi due to Leonhard Euler. Leonhard Euler is totally blind. He lost his first eye in 1738 and next eye in 1766. And he passed away only in 83. That means for 17 years he was totally blind. What is the moral of the story? Mathematics aspirants should have a third eye, not the physical eye, but the eye that you have in your brain. So those who have brain, please use your brain to crack your nut or jam or bread or whatever you want. Okay. So mathematician's dream is always to get the Fields Medal. So my third question is, you should immediately write the answer in the chat box, those who want to get the gift. Whose head appears in the Fields Medal? Fine. So homage to Maryam Mirza Ghani, who was the only woman mathematician and the only Iranian to get a Fields Medal, who passed away in 2017. She was awarded Fields Medal along with Manjul Bhargava in 2014. And I was fortunate enough to attend that congress in Seoul, Korea, when Manjul Bhargava, Maryam Mirza Ghani and others received the Fields Medal. So we have two Indian names in the Fields Medal list. Indian names are a bit, they are not Indian citizens. 2014 Fields Medal, the great. So identify these two persons is another question. Who are the Indian names in the Fields Medal list? There is an equally covetous prize called Abel Prize, named after Neil Henrik Abel, who was there only for 27 years and he did wonders. And there is a prestigious Indian name, Srinivasa Varadhan, who got Abel Prize in 2007 and who has visited Cochin University Mathematics Department, to my knowledge, at least 3 times. So the mathematics building in Cochin University is a sacred building in the sense that many, many, many great mathematicians have visited that place, and that is where some of the students of this generation is attending classes. So congratulations to another giant who came to Cochin for attending my conference in 2010 was Laszlo Lavas, who is an Nobel laureate in 2021. And I'm happy to tell you that we are going to honor him sometime in September. We will arrange a webinar and I will invite you all to have a look at, to see Laszlo Lavas giving a talk. Okay, so we are arranging, Cochin University Mathematics Department is arranging a webinar where Laszlo Lavas is going to talk sometime in September. We are yet to get the date. So mathematics, what is mathematics? Is mathematics is everywhere. From actuarial science to ethnographic science, artificial intelligence to computational neuroscience, epidemiology, entertainment industry, music, machine learning, mathematical endoscopy, mathematical oncology, photogrammetry, remote sensing and quantum computation and what not. What is this mathematical oncology? Mathematical modeling techniques to check the growth of cells which causes cancer. So mathematics is there. Mathematics is there. Mathematics is here. Mathematics is in Uttar Pradesh. Mathematics is in Bangladesh. Mathematics is in India. Hello? So I'll come to Gilbert's 23 problems, called the problems of the mathematics, and also 1 minute for millennium problems. You will get $1 million, so 75 million Indian rupees when you solve this. So Hilbert, the great German philosopher mathematician Hilbert, posed this problem in 1900 ICM, held in 1900 in Paris. And let me tell you, during 1900, Hilbert was not known to the mathematical community. He was a youngster, a young boy. Nobody had heard about Hilbert. And he posed some 23 problems, of which only 8 were presented in the conference, to inspire youngsters to solve this. And I don't know the current status. Those who can report to me what is the current status of the solutions. I know that most of them have been solved. But why I brought in this Hilbert's problem is there is only one problem which is common to the millennium problem and the Hilbert's problem, is that is Riemann hypothesis. So Birch and Swinnerton and Dyer conjecture, Hodge conjecture, Navier-Stokes assistance and smoothness, P versus NP in theoretical computer science, Poincaré conjecture, Riemann hypothesis and Yang-Mills existence and mass gap. Of which, though announced in 2000, there is only one problem that has been solved after a span of about, I think, 2 years. That is Poincaré conjecture, and solved by the great Gregory Perelman. Interestingly, he declined the prize money. Also, he declined the Fields Medal. I was fortunate enough to attend the 2006 ICM in Spain, where his name was announced. We were all eagerly waiting to meet Gregory Perelman, but he didn't come to receive the Fields Medal. So this is the great saint. What does he say? I am not interested in money or fame. I don't want to be on display like an animal in a zoo. Oh, this is Gregory Perelman. This is Gregory Perelman. He will not freedom. He will not have freedom to do mathematics. So he simply declined. And there is a beautiful interview of Gregory Perelman with a lady journalist. My next question is, can you name the book? Name the book, which is actually the biography of Perelman, interviewed by a lady journalist. Name the book. Okay, so this is great Riemann. One happy news that I wanted to share and repeatedly share is that Riemann hypothesis is still open. Okay, so Hilbert asked, if I were to awaken after having slept for 1,000 years, my first question would be, has the Riemann hypothesis been proven? So recently there was a news item in the papers. Let me tell you frankly, newspapers is not the place to declare a mathematical result. That will make them unnecessarily cheaply famous, but nothing is going to happen. If I get a mathematical theorem, I send to a journal, not to Malayala Manorama or Indian Express. Experts should certify. And in this case, experts have not certified the proof of Riemann hypothesis, and the great certificate is that of Hilbert. He is prepared to spend another 1,000 years to see that Riemann hypothesis is proved. Fine. So let me start the journey. So complex numbers, nth root of a complex number, nth roots of unity. If you are comfortable with all these things, though, if you know, I will start asking some small questions like, what is the geometry of the roots of unity? Where does these roots of unity lie? especially nth roots of unity. That is, solve z raised to n is equal to 1. So z is 1 raised to 1 by n, that is the nth roots of unity. Cube roots of unity, fifth roots of unity, sixth root of unity. What is the geometry of this? Where does these roots lie? That was an NBHM question. Now we have Riemann sphere, complex functions. So do you find some properties different from real functions? I'll come to this later. So more intricate questions. Why do you need complex numbers? Can you give some properties of complex functions which differ from real functions? What are all the ways of defining an analytic function? If you are putting the third question in a university question paper, only one question is enough. I am proud to say that those students whom I taught complex analysis know the answer. I don't know how many of them are sitting. What are all the different approaches to the definition of analytic functions? What is integral of complex function? Another exciting question is Cauchy's theorem and Cauchy's integral formula equivalent? And the most surprising question is, can you prove Cayley-Hamilton theorem? What is Cayley-Hamilton theorem? Every square matrix satisfies its characteristic equation. Can you prove Cayley-Hamilton theorem using Cauchy's integral formula? Are baba, kya baat rahe ho? What nonsense are you talking? Cauchy's integral formula is in complex analysis and Cayley-Hamilton theorem is in matrix theory. How can I prove Cayley-Hamilton theorem using Cauchy's integral formula? And that is the beauty of mathematics. Confused? You want to relax for a second? Please relax. Can you prove Cauchy's integral for, sorry, Cayley-Hamilton theorem using Cauchy's integral formula? I have given this as an assignment for tutorials in my Cochin University, and I am happy that some of my students did do it as a tutorial. I am sure that if Rahul is there, Rahul has done it. I can still give you the handwritten notes of Rahul because I keep it with me. And finally, the enigma of Riemann hypothesis. What is so great about Riemann hypothesis? So I show you a number of great mathematicians. All you have to do is to identify them. I have given a hint. I have given the span of life of all these people. So from left to right, or in the matrix language, you write the first row first and the second row second, and you keep the answer with you. But all the names that I have been repeatedly telling are all, I have shown all of them. So this is the complex number. You require two parameters to fix a complex number. It's of the form a plus ib. And there is a beautiful isomorphism between the set of all complex numbers and the set of all ordered pairs of real numbers. R2 is same as C in the sense that the ordered pair ab goes to a plus ib is the isomorphism. It is all due to Descartes. It's a French name. It is not Descartes. It is Descartes. So this, all of you know, this is real part and imaginary part. So complex numbers allow solutions to all polynomial equations. Even those that have no solutions in real numbers is what is called the fundamental theorem of algebra, which is the PhD thesis of Gauss. Just 40 pages. The most general form. That means complex coefficients also. So I cannot solve x plus 1 square is equal to negative 16 in x if x is real. There are BSc students, do you agree with me? I cannot solve in real numbers x plus 1 square is equal to minus 16 because as per the fundamental properties of the real number system, square of a real number can never be negative. Am I right? Are there BSc students in this group?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So, is it okay that what I said is correct?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I cannot solve this system in real numbers doesn't mean I cannot solve forever. That is the problem with the student. They don't understand the premises where which I am going to ask question. X power n plus y power n is equal to z power n is true, not in the integers, but maybe in some other system. So where do you want to solve the system? The Fermat's last theorem, x power n plus y power n is not equal to z power n. I don't have an integral solution. Such equations are called Diophantine equations. So fundamental theorem of algebra says that I can solve x plus 1 square is equal to negative 16. So the complex numbers form also a real vector space of dimension 2 with 1i as a standard basis. I can add and multiply complex numbers. Complex conjugation is reflection symmetry with respect to the real axis. The absolute value of the complex number gives me the Euclidean norm. So look at the ways in which I try to connect these things. You have to get connected in many ways. You have to see many different properties in the same thing. And that is how mathematics is learned. Okay, so complex numbers form a field. I will add more adjective in the next slide. It is not only that it is a field, it is something else, but it is not something else also. It is not a totally ordered field. It's an ordered field, no. It's a vector space of dimension 2. Two-ness. Dimension 2 means two-ness in the sense that only two linearly independent set is enough to span the complex number system. So complex numbers is algebraically closed. It's a commutative algebra. It's a vector space. So three properties of same C. As a number system, I need not search outside the complex numbers to solve any polynomial equation. That is the fundamental theorem of algebra. What is a commutative algebra? Commutative algebra is an associative algebra where you have the algebraic structure of a ring. The addition gives a vector space, etc. So it's a associative algebra. So a commutative algebra is an associative algebra that has a commutative multiplication. I can multiply two numbers, complex numbers, and you can, it's a commutative, order is not important. So it's an associative algebra that is also a commutative ring. You can ask me, I will relax for a minute. You can ask me why you want to see C in different ways. Why should C have a different avatars? Why do you want to see is an algebraic closed field? Why do you want to see is a vector space? And why do you want to see is a commutative algebra? The BSc students attending this may not know, but at least keep this question with you, ponder the answer, and whenever you get the answer, reflect back. Fine. So some basic worries. Is complex exponential function injective? What is the logarithm of minus 3? Are Baba, logarithm of negative number, I don't know. I will run away. Oh, logarithm of the complex number 1 plus I. What is I raised to I? My pet question in all entrance test of Cochin University prepared by me till 2 years ago. I will repeatedly ask what is I raised to I. Is it meaningful logarithm of minus 3? Yes or no? Please unmute and answer. Is logarithm of minus 3 okay?
No.
Yes. Logarithm of minus 3 is not okay when you are considering the real logarithm. But when you know the logarithm of a complex number, minus 3 is only a negative number, integer. So logarithm of 1 plus I, if it is defined, logarithm of minus 3 is nothing. There we are used the formula that of the polar coordinates of a complex number, x plus iy can also be written as r theta, r ei theta, r n theta, where r is root of x square plus y square, and theta is tan inverse y by x. So the Cartesian coordinate system is replaced by the polar coordinates, r and theta. X plus iy goes to r theta, where r is r ei theta, where r is root of x square plus y square, and theta is tan inverse y by x, what's called the modulus and amplitude of a complex number. So logarithm of a complex number z is logarithm of r ei theta, which is log r plus I into theta. But the complex exponential function is not injective beyond, because there is a, that's what I asked you in the beginning. Can you give me an example of a situation where complex functions differ from real functions? So complex exponential function is, fill up the blanks. Complex exponential function is, yes, please, you can answer.
Periodic.
Periodic. Who is that person who told the answer?
Sir Rabika. Rabika.
Please tell your name loudly and the institution.
Rabika, I passed out from Delhi University. I am from Sikkim.
Good, very good. She used the word periodic. Is it a real period? No. It's an imaginary period.
No, sir. Imaginary period, yeah.
So e raised to I theta is e raised to I theta plus 2 pi. So the period is, the principal period or basic periods is on the horizontal axis, sorry, horizontal strip. Okay, so it is periodic means f of x plus t is f of x. Every t, you know, sine function is periodic, etc., etc. So when you know the complex logarithm, that value of the logarithm whose theta lies between 0 to 2 pi is what's called the principal value. Fine. So I can define complex power of a complex number, which you never expect at the real analysis level. You arrange a debate, which is stronger, real analysis versus complex analysis in colleges. Somebody arguing for real analysis beauty and somebody arguing for complex analysis beauty. I will join the complex analysis group. What is I raised to I? I raised to I is E raised to I log I. The rest you can complete. Now, what is the geometry of F sub is equal to K times Z? K is real, K is complex. When K is complex, K can be written as mod K E raised to I theta, or E raised to I Z. Sorry, E raised to I theta. So K is a complex number. So any complex number can be written as R E I theta. So I'm multiplying a complex number by another complex number is different from multiplying a complex number by a real number. So when you have F of Z equal to I times Z, or in general K times Z, where K is complex, is not only a magnification but a rotation, because K is mod K raised to I theta and the angle gets added up by theta. Because Z itself is a complex number. So suppose I put K is equal to mod K e raised to I theta and Z equal to R e raised to I phi. Because of the properties of the exponentiation, that phi gets added up. sorry, it started up by theta. So with this, all this information, I ask you, what is the effect of multiplying a complex number by I? What is the geometry? What will happen when you multiply a complex number by I?
Rotation by 90 degrees.
290 degrees. Because I is your imaginary unit and it's a theta is pi by 2. So e raised to I pi by 2. So all those is done. Therefore, multiplying a complex number by I is just rotating the complex number Z through an angle 90 degrees, pi by 2. Another beautiful thing of complex analysis is stereographic projection. One onto map from the extended complex plane to extended top plane. You know, C union infinity is a sphere. That's what's called the one-point compactification of the complex plane. Looks like a sphere, unit sphere, what is called the Riemann sphere. Okay, we can add the point at infinity and make any locally compact Hausdorff space to a compact Hausdorff space. That's the process is called one-point compactification. I can add only one point. And if you add a point at infinity to C, you can see that it is homeomorphic to the sphere, normalized, it's a unit sphere, which is a 1-1 onto bijective map. It's a conformal mapping, meaning that it preserves angles. I'll come to this point later. So what is the advantage that we have done? You are able to accommodate all complex numbers, including the point at infinity, inside and on the unit sphere, x square plus y square plus z square is equal to 1. So the mapping, which takes any point in the complex plane to a point on the sphere, is what's called the stereographic projection. Stereo means three-dimensional. So corresponding to every point in the sphere, including the point at, including the north pole, which is projected to the point at infinity. So corresponding to every P dashed in the sphere, there exists a point P, which is the projection of this point P dashed onto the complex plane in a 1-1 onto manner. And that mapping is called stereographic projection. I think page number 8 or 9 of Alfus. What is sign of Mona Lisa? I want to share a private personal information about this. I have taught complex analysis for several years, for several batches. But I went to Canada in a university. At the entrance of the university, this question was there. What is sign of Mona Lisa? Chakkar ho gaya. I didn't know the answer. I was quite surprised. And it was also, I was inspired by that question. What is Mona Lisa, the most beautiful picture in the world? By whom?
Leonardo
da Vinci, isn't it? Yes, Leonardo da Vinci. The Mona Lisa picture is full of mystery. I will talk about this in some other forum. Mona Lisa is a cryptic object. There are a lot of secrecy in it. But my question is, what is the sign of Mona Lisa? Does it make any sense at all? What do you feel about it? I'm not at all in a hurry. I don't have any agenda. When you want me to stop, I will stop. So I don't have any agenda. I have hundreds of pages of presentation, but doesn't mean anything. What does this? Does this make any sense at all to talk about sign of Mona Lisa? And the technology brings the answer. Sign of Mona Lisa is something complicated figure like this. Mona Lisa is beautiful, undoubtedly, but sign of Mona Lisa is, I think, not beautiful. It's ugly. It's a curve like this, because sine function is a nonlinear function. What is the sign of Mona Lisa? It's an example of a conformal map. The image on the right is a visualization of airflow past a flat aerofoil. The flow follows the blue curves in the direction from left to right. The curves are level contours obtained from a complex valued function sine set. You please look at the Google. So sign of Vinod Kumar or Bijuman could be very ugly, though both of them look smart. Okay, so you take your own photograph and apply sine function or cos function, and you can see the real beauty because sine is nonlinear. So this is analytic function theory is complex function theory. So I asked you in the first few slides, what are all the ways of defining analytic function or looking at the analytic function, and that is the beauty of complex analysis. When you start learning complex analysis and analytic function, there comes a pair of partial differential equations, Cauchy-Riemann equations. A system of two partial differential equations, what are they? If f of z is equal to u of xy plus iv of xy, what is the Cauchy-Riemann equation?
Ux is equal to vy and uy is equal to minus vx.
Correct.
Where, yes.
Your name, please.
My name is Kana Bindal from the Dayalbagh Educational Institute, Agra.
Suna nahi. Kahan se?
Sir, Dayalbagh Educational Institute, Agra.
Oh, Agra. Agra se bahut log aaye hain. Good. So where are the Kerala boys and girls? This is Olympics. Olympics of complex analysis. You have to run fast to get the gold. But if you are not interested in even one medal, very good. So this system of partial differential, ux is equal to vy and uy is equal to minus vx, which forms a necessary, together with the continuity and differentiability criteria, makes as the necessary and the sufficient condition for a complex function to be complex differentiable or holomorphic. So I use different words, holomorphic and analytic, and the beauty of complex analysis is that both are same. Differentiability of complex functions implies and implied by existence of a convergent power series representation of the function. Point number two, point of view of number two in looking at the complex analysis, complex analytic functions. A function is holomorphic at a point A if it is differentiable at every point within some open disk centered at A. Let me spend 1 minute. What is the difference between the differentiability of real valued function and complex valued function? I suppose you know examples of all the cases, real valued function of a real variable, real valued function of a complex variable, complex valued function of a real variable, and complex valued function of a complex variable. I suppose you know the answer, right? Yeah, from R to R, you know plenty because you know real analysis. You know F from C to C because you know complex analysis. How about C to R? Real valued function of a complex variable.
Sir, modulus of the complex number.
Good. The other possibility, real to complex. Real to complex.
Sir, e to the power I, that real number, e to the power ix.
Oh, fine. You need not go that far, x plus ix square. Okay, x square plus ix cube. So real valued function of a complex variable, complex valued function of a real variable, all possibilities are there. And towards the end of the complex analysis course, first course, you will realize that any function which is differentiable, complex differentiable, is equivalent to or admits a convergent power series representation. I'll come to that point later. Some people have started thinking, what are the applications? Where do you find applications of these analysis? Any real valued continuous function which satisfies this Laplace equation or is called a harmonic function, del square u by del x square plus del square u by del y square is equal to 0. That is what's called the Laplace equation, and the solution of the Laplace equation is harmonic function. Fine. So if you give me one, I shall give you two. If you give me 1000 analytic functions, I will give you 2000 harmonic functions. If you give me two harmonic functions, I will give you plenty of harmonic functions. And if you don't give me anything, I'm sorry, I cannot do anything. So if you give me one, very generous. If you give me one, I will give you two. If you give me 1000 rupees, I'll give you 2000 rupees. Aye. In that case, you would have attended many more such programs, isn't it? Vinod Kumar and Bijuman cannot sleep now from today. This is an offer. Anybody who is attending, you give me 1000 rupees, I will give you 2000 rupees. Not I, Vinod Kumar and Bijuman will give. Okay. So my demand is, my generosity is that if you give me 1000 analytic functions, I'm sure that I can give you return 2000 harmonic functions, because anybody who knows the answer?
Yes, sir.
Because if f is equals to u plus ip is analytic, then both u and v are harmonic.
Very simple D. Very simple D. The real and imaginary part of an analytic function is are harmonic, and every harmonic function is locally the real or imaginary part of an analytic function. If we take a harmonic function u and another harmonic function v, another harmonic function v, it is not true that u plus iv is analytic. No. I stand here and you bring someone else's wife, we are not partners. So given Vijay Kumar, there exists a unique lady who is the wife of this, so that we become pairs, right? So take a real harmonic function and another harmonic function. You take x square minus y square and sine y, sine xy, sorry, sine cos x or sine x. So real and imaginary parts of analytic functions are harmonic doesn't mean, I repeatedly say, given u, there exists a v, what is called the harmonic conjugate of u, such that u plus iv is analytic. So if you take x square minus y square as u, you know it is harmonic. There exist 2xy such that x square minus y square plus 2 times i2xy is analytic. So given x square minus y square, there exists 2xy. There is a standard method for finding the harmonic conjugate.
What is it? U is unique.
Harmonic. Ku is harmonic. And if u and v are harmonic, u plus v is harmonic. Therefore, the set of all harmonic functions form a
vector space over R.
Vector space.
Vector space, sir.
So you know many things. You are very smart. You are very smart. Let me go out of complex analysis for a while. You inspired me to tell this. I got my first job in Regional Engineering College, Calicut. That is the present NIT Calicut. That was my first appointment. Before that, I had taught 84, 86 batch of Cochin University MSc students informally, because I completed my PhD in 1985, so I was jobless. So my guru Abhijit told me, you teach something for fourth semester of 84-86 batch. And undoubtedly, they are the most personal, most favorite batch for me because they tolerated me. I keep in touch with them, 84-86. I taught complex analysis for them. Then I went to REC Calicut. There also I got the assignment of teaching complex analysis. So the first formal lecture or formal class of mine was in complex analysis, fifth semester civil engineering batch, 1986. I recently contacted a couple of students of that batch. It's easy now because of your Facebook and WhatsApp and all. They're all big, big people. They are superintendent engineers, chief engineers, and so on. That is the happiness that a teacher gets when your students excel the teacher. So my appeal to all the students attending this math aspirants program is excel the teacher. The teacher should be proud that you are my student. Okay, take it as a pledge, independence pledge. You will outsmart your teacher. You then once become laurels, bring laurels to the country, you get a Fields Medal. You get a Bhatnagar Prize. You get an INSA Prize. You get a Government of India Prize for Best Mathematician. You get several accolades. Then one day, Vinod Kumar and Vijayamohan will be happy to see that, oh, they were all my math aspirant students. Just like they are happy when you see the list of students from, say, CUSAT admission or JAM or JEE or whatever it is. Okay, so give back to your institution. Give back to your teachers. So salute this great man whose complex analysis book has been taught all over the world. L. V. Alfords. What is his credit? He is the first Fields Medalist. He shared Fields Medal with, I think it is Atle Selberg. I'm not sure, sorry. You please get it from Google. So first Fields Medal goes to, shared by L.V. Alfords, Finland mathematician. What is a citation? Awarded medal for research on covering surfaces related to Riemann surfaces of inverse functions of entire and meromorphic functions opened up new fields of analysis. So namaste Alfords, because Alfords is teaching us complex analysis. Undoubtedly, to me, the best book, because as a teacher, I have taught from many different books, but finally we converged at complex analysis book by Alfords. There's also another personal thing which I want to share with you. I had taught Sergey Lang's complex analysis also. So I was the habit of writing letters. That's how I wrote letters to even Dr. Kalam. So I wrote a letter to Sergey Lang, a professor in, I think, Yale University, way back in 86, while I was teaching complex analysis from his book. That is the only book in complex analysis where you teach conformal mapping without drawing any picture. So geometry is algebraized through the arguments of inner product spaces. So I wrote a letter to Sergey Lang saying that your book doesn't contain Riemann zeta function, number theory, etc. Therefore, to fit to the Indian audience, Indian students, you better include Riemann zeta function and all that in the textbook and prepare a new edition. But you know what Sergey Lang told? Of course, I think there was no email, through letters. Hello, Vijay Kumar, you do one thing, you write a chapter on Riemann zeta function, send to me, I will make you as a co-author and write a book as Sergey Lang and Vijay Kumar, Complex Analysis, Edition 2. But I said, no, that's not proper. If you write an article on Riemann zeta function, you please send to me. I will apply my mind and see that there are some corrections are made and send you back. So who was lazier was the question. Either is it me or Lang? You know, the story ends like this. In the third edition of the complex analysis book, Sergey Lang has thanked me for helping to complete the book on Riemann zeta function. That is the confidence that Professor Abdi gave me to talk about complex analysis. So next is geometry of complex functions. Conformal mapping, Mobius transformation, cross ratio. Mobius transformation, it's not Mobius. As you all know, a function of the form Z plus B by C Z plus D, A, B, C, D complex numbers. Yes.
Sir, a doubt. Sir, you said that every UX have a unique V. Is it right?
No. Unique V, we can multiply by K. No, no. Unique V, yeah. Yes.
But there are constant adding to this. Then can we say that it is a family of... Family of... Family of is it a family of V's or
yes, given you there exists a V, and if you keep on changing, you get a different V's. For example, if you take Z square, which is real part is X square minus Y square, and imaginary part is 2XY, and X square minus Y square is harmonic, 2XY is harmonic, and that gives a unique combination to get Z square, which are real and imaginary parts of Z square. That's what I told.
Sir, sometimes there have a V plus a constant.
Yeah. Value. That's okay. That I agree.
Okay. Then it is a different, as C changes, the function will be changing. Yeah, right?
No. If you have a Z square, that is X square minus Y square plus I times 2XY. The real and imaginary part of analytic function are harmonic.
Okay,
that's what I told. Okay, so take the Mobius transformation A Z plus B by C Z plus D, where A B C D is in C. Immediately you write A D minus B C is equal to zero, not equal to zero. Why that condition? What will happen if A D minus B C is equal to zero? Hello.
The derivative becomes zero, sir.
Okay, what is the problem if derivative becomes zero? Before that, you answer. Don't jump to the answer before you say that the function reduces to a constant, right?
Yes.
Yeah. What is the problem of constant functions? You said derivative is zero, right? So what is the problem if derivative is zero?
The function becomes constant.
You complete the answer. There is no part answer in mathematics, though you will get marks for part answer. That's a very unscientific method of thinking.
Sir, then it will not preserve the angle between the curves.
Yes. That loses the property of conformality. You are right. And we are all bringing to look at the geometry of the mapping, not simplicity. So these transformations have the property that they transform preserve angles, conformal, map every straight line to a line or a circle, and map every circle to a line or a circle. It's a circle preserving transformation which forms a group under the composition, what's called the Mobius group. So the theory of Mobius transformation can be taken to the field of group theory. Look at the group properties, what's called modular group and all that. It is a, I think, subgroup or of this group called modular group, in the sense that, or unitary group like that, I don't remember. Those transformations whose determinant is 1, plus or minus 1. They're also called bilinear transformations, fractional linear transformations, etc. Why is it called bilinear? Why conformal mapping, sorry, Mobius transformation is also called bilinear transformation.
The structure preserves. Only reversing or inverse transformation is similar fashion, sir.
Sorry, I didn't hear.
Sir, here there are two things. There are inversion also.
Yeah.
So it is bilinear.
Yes, correct. So both the WZ and its inverse are linear. Therefore, it's called bilinear. Okay. So Mobius transformation is always a bijective holomorphic function from Riemann sphere to Riemann sphere. That means including point at infinity. We take a z plus b by c z plus d. When c z plus d is equal to zero, you become infinity. So c z plus d is equal to zero means z equal to minus d by c is a mapping which goes x minus d by c to zero infinity. So it's a bijective holomorphic function. It's a product of translation, rotation, and inversion. Rules of translation and rotation are simple because it gets translated or it gets rotated. So the properties of Mobius transformation are studied using the fact that it's a product of translation, rotation, and inversion. Every non-identity Mobius transformation has two fixed points, and if you have two fixed points, it's called a parabolic transformation. So there is a major classification of Mobius transformation into three: elliptic transformation, parabolic transformation, and hyperbolic transformation. If you look at Alford's book, you see the difference. Okay. Discuss the mapping properties of Z goes to Z square. It's conformal at all points except Z equal to. Is it equal to?
Z equal to zero.
Equal to zero.
Is it equal to zero? What does that mean? It is conformal at all points except is it equal to zero means, except at is it equal to zero, any two curves intersecting at theta at a point is it not equal to zero will be mapped onto curves which also will intersect at an angle same theta. But for the point z equal to zero, what is called the critical point. Therefore, what will happen to two curves which will cut at an angle theta at the point zero? The mapping is z goes to z square. What will do for r? R will go to r square. Theta will go to 2 theta, right? Z square angle gets added up, right? Am I right? Okay, sir. Fine.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Three bags full. One for my master and one for my dame, and one for my little princess. Very good. So, what will happen to lines parallel to the axis? Okay, I will start. Look at all points such that x is equal to constant. X coordinate is constant, that is parallel to y-axis. Under the mapping, z goes to z square. What will happen?
A circle?
No.
Circle.
Hmm? Come on. What will happen to the parallel lines x is equal to okay. K and y is equal to, look at x is equal to K.
Parabolas.
X coordinate is
a circle. It will go to a circle and the other one will go to a straight line.
One answer is they will go to straight line and circle. I heard some other answer.
Parabolas.
Semicircle.
Parabolas. Some other answer.
Sir, what is the function?
Z square.
Z square.
Upper half thing.
Okay, it's an elementary exercise. Yeah, tell me. Tell me. There is an elementary exercise in Alford's or any other book. Straight lines parallel to axis will go to set of parabolas because x is z square. The mapping is x square minus y square plus I times 2xy. You can easily prove that parallel axis goes, parallel lines go to, sorry, lines parallel to axis goes to hyperbolas. Similarly, you discuss the mapping property of fz equal to 1 by z. So the Mobius transformation is a composition of translation, rotation, and inversion. The two functions properties are simple, translation and rotation. The only slightly tricky is inversion. And there will enjoy the property of circle preserving property, including straight line, because straight line is extended circle. You take a circle and you hit at the head, it will become a straight line. Okay. So only slightly tricky properties only for f z equal to 1 by z. So this is the usual question that you come across in university questions, like find the Mobius transformations which map 0, 1, infinity to minus 5, minus 1, 3. I'm not asking you to solve this problem. You can take home and do it later. But what is the property that you are going to use? In fixing up the map, only three points are in it. Wait, let me come to one more point.
The cross
asset plus b by c b.
Cross ratio property.
Yeah, one second. The transformation has four constants a, b, c, d. But 3 points is enough to fix the mapping, because there are essentially only three variables, coefficients a, b, c, d. You divide by d, you can make it to three variables, three constants. So 3 points are enough to fix the mapping. Just like 2 points are enough to fix a straight line. So what property of the Mobius transformation is used? Somebody already told.
Translational.
Bilinear transformation. Bilinear.
Cross ratio.
Cross ratio. Okay.
Cross ratio is?
Bilinear transformation.
Invariant under bilinear transformation, right? Therefore, you find the cross ratio of these points, you can find this transformation. I will give you answer. It is 3z minus I by 1 plus z. Almost every time what I have seen as a teacher is that you just give this answer and keep quiet, saying that this is correct, but you never bother to verify it. Is 3z minus I by 1 plus z correct? Yes, because z go 0 goes to minus 5. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Minus 5 by 1 plus z.
Yes, sir.
0 goes to minus 5. 1 goes to what?
Minus 1.
And infinity goes to 3, or 3 goes to infinity?
Infinity goes to 3, sir.
Okay. Now get to part 2. Integral of a complex function. Integral fz dz over a path gamma. Gamma is a continuous image of closed interval 0 to 2 pi for convenience. So integral of a complex function over a path. And we have classical theorems, complex Cauchy's theorem and Cauchy's integral formula. And in the Cauchy's integral formula, we have a beautiful concept called winding number. And it is the surprise. That is another beauty of complex integration, that winding number, an integer, can be expressed as a complex integral. 1 by 2 pi I integral fz by z minus a dz is winding number of gamma with respect to a. Very, very surprising. A crooked complex integral could be an integer. So let me ask my usual question in the test papers of Cusat. For every integer n, there exists a curve whose winding number is n. True or false? For every n, whether it is positive or negative integer, there exists a closed curve gamma such that winding number of gamma with respect to a point is that integer. True or false?
Set true.
What is that curve?
That times into the circle.
I want the simplest possible answer, simplest possible curve.
Sir, circle.
You cannot draw it, but what is the parametric equation? Winding number is n means, are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
Winding number is n. it winds round the point n times. Winding number of a closed curve with respect to a point.
The curve is e to the power I theta, where theta varies from 0 to 2n pi.
Okay, you bring that n inside and say that theta varies from 0 to 2 pi.
Yes, sir.
Fine. So winding number, every positive, every integer could be winding number, taking into consideration orientation, it could be negative or positive. Okay. So that is the only, yeah. So winding number could be non-zero or zero. And that is the only way of defining interior of a closed curve, that is through complex analysis. I repeatedly say, if you look at the Google, you can find examples of closed curve, which are very crooked closed curve, where you cannot say which is interior or which is exterior. To take a closed circle disk, you know how to find interior and exterior, anybody can do. But the most beautiful way of defining an interior is through winding number. So winding number, sorry, the interior of a closed curve consists of all those points whose winding number is not equal to zero. It could be any integer. Whereas the closed curve does not wind round points outside it, so that is zero. So winding number is either zero or not zero. It is not zero for all points which are inside the circle curve, and zero for all points outside, because a closed curve does not wind round a point outside it. So what your Cauchy's theorem says is that if two different parts connect the same two points and the function is holomorphic everywhere in between the two parts, then the two path integrals of the function will be the same. Therefore, integral for every closed path is zero. So if you want to integrate 1 by z dz, I cannot apply Cauchy's theorem because there is a dangerous point inside gamma, which is e raised to it. So simple complex integration techniques will tell you that integral 1 by z dz is 2 pi I, because z equal to 0 is a dangerous point. Right? Integral f z dz is f of gamma of t, gamma dashed tt dt from 0 to 2 pi. So is it okay with the simple integral? Simple example, integral 1 by z dz is 2 pi I. But had I integrated integral z dz over the same interval 0 to 2 pi, you can check the answer. Okay. A holomorphic function defined on a disk is completely determined by its values on the boundary of the disk. That is Cauchy's integral formula for the nth derivative. Sorry, Cauchy's integral formula says that I am going to find the value of the function at the interior point in terms of its values on the boundary, because my variation is from 0 to 2 pi, means it's on the boundary. Not only that, it gives integral formulas for all derivatives of holomorphic functions. And Cauchy's formula shows that in complex analysis, differentiation is equivalent integration, in the sense that differentiation and integration behaves well under uniform limits, and this is not true in the case of real analysis. I'll come to this point after 1 minute. So therefore, I can find the nth derivative of a function in terms of the values of the function over the boundary. So f(n) is n factorial by 2 pi I into integral f z by z minus a raised to n plus 1 dz. In fact, on the left, you have winding number also. Fine. The most spectacular theorem for me is Liouville's theorem, because the proof that Professor Abdi gave me about 40 years ago is still in my memory. you repeatedly told something which I am going to ask you. Before that, integral is independent of path if and only if. Integrand is what?
Y the number is zero.
Wait. I'm talking in terms of
analytic. If the function is analytic.
Analytic. Something more. It is too much, but an
in a closed curve.
I want to look at this in a different way.
Antiderivative.
Wait. Integral is independent of path if and only if integrand is, fill up the blanks.
If it's antiderivative,
potential function.
Come on, precise. Be precise.
Exact.
Sir, analytic in the connected.
There is a potential.
Somebody told me the keyword. Somebody wrote the keyword. Integral is independent of path if and only if.
Analytic in connected domain.
Exact.
Okay, integrand. Let me complete. Integrand is exact differential.
Yeah.
Okay, not only that, integrand is an antiderivative in the sense that there exists another function whose derivative is this given function. Therefore, if you want to integrate integral z cube dz for in around any curve gamma joining a to b, I need not bother about which path that I am going to integrate. Integral is independent of the path. So integral of gamma 1 is same as integral over gamma 2. So integral over gamma 1 minus gamma 2 becomes 0. That is Cauchy's term. So in a problem, if you are asking me to solve, find the integral from a plus ib to c plus id, there are infinite number of paths joining a plus bi to c plus id, but I need not bother at all, provided the integrand is an exact differential or antiderivative. To calculate it becomes very easy. I need not worry about which path that I should integrate. I can do via circle, via parabola, via ellipse, or whatever crooked path you want to do. Integral is independent of path. That is beautiful Cauchy's theorem. As a consequence of the Cauchy's integral formula for antiderivative and Cauchy's estimate, we can look at the beautiful theorem in complex analysis that every bounded entire function is a constant. Every bounded entire function is a constant. Can anyone give the proof of this using Cauchy's estimate for nth derivative? Are there any Pusat MSc students here? Hello? I think they are all meditating. This is what they are doing. Right?
Sir, I did not get the question. Can you please repeat it?
Yes. Liouville's theorem, name under this. This is the guy, Liouville, Joseph Liouville. Every bounded entire function, a function is entire means it's analytic everywhere. Means radius of convergence of the power series is infinite. It's analytic everywhere. So every bounded entire function is a constant. It's named after Liouville, but first proof was by Cauchy. You can assume the Cauchy's estimate and give one line proof for Liouville's theorem. Okay. If not, is Liouville's theorem true? Two questions that I am going to ask. Is sine z, sine function in complex variable, is it bounded? Is sine x bounded?
Sine x is bounded.
No, sir. Sine x is bounded, but sine z is not bounded.
Yeah. You gave the answer one step ahead. sin x is bounded between minus 1 and 1. Sin z,
yes, sir.
Sin z is unbounded, follows as a consequence of using this theorem. Am I right?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Every bounded entire function is constant. A and B implies C. Therefore, if you take a function which is entire and not a constant, it cannot be bounded. Sine function is entire and sine function is obviously not a constant. Therefore, sine function is not bounded. This is one of the drastic differences between real sine z, real sine, and complex sine. You can use Lievely's theorem to prove fundamental theorem of algebra. And you can prove fundamental theorem of algebra in at least 8 ways. And that is precisely a syllabus for Cochin University MPhil. Okay, so I am connecting several things.
Sir.
So those who are doing this, please.
Sir, I can prove it by using Lievely's theorem.
Which one?
Fundamental theorem of algebra.
I'm asking you to prove Lievely's theorem using Cauchy's estimate. Is it possible? Cauchy's estimate for nth derivative of an NRT function says that f n is less than or equal to mn factorial by r raised to n, right?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
You have not studied that, forget about it. Don't worry. F n a is less than or equal to mn factorial by r raised to n. Because r is, sorry, function is entire, what will happen for r?
R tends to infinity.
Because radius of convergence is infinite. I can allow the infinite behavior. And I am worried only about first derivative is zero, therefore function is constant, right?
Yes, sir.
But Cauchy's estimate is got by Cauchy's integral formula. So, Lievely's theorem can be asked as a question for 2 marks or even 10 marks, because if it is for 10 marks, you have to first prove Cauchy's integral formula, get the Cauchy's estimate, and then prove Lievely's theorem, right?
Yes, sir.
Good. Okay. Mathematics students will not sleep, they will only meditate. Dhyanam, just like saints do. Okay, we will all meditate. Others will think that we are thinking, but we are meditating. Okay, so we don't sleep actually, inside the class especially. See, there are, I've seen over 30 years, there are certain students, the moment you enter the class, they start sleeping. They believe that classroom is for sleeping. The moment they study complex analysis, they start sleeping. I know a couple of students. I don't know. My dear students like Anne and Gia, I don't know how are they. Okay, just for fun, I am telling all these things. I know that they are all really smart. Okay, fine. I will take only another 15 to 20 minutes maximum, 15 minutes. I am slowly started converging. So other classical theorems in analysis are maximum modulus theorem, Cauchy's residue theorem, Taylor's theorem and Lorentz theorem. These are the people behind this, Taylor and Laurent. Laurent is not the correct pronunciation, Laura. And classical Riemann mapping theorem and Riemann hypothesis. Okay. What does Riemann mapping theorem say? This comes on the second course on complex analysis. There's a beautiful proof of Riemann hypothesis, sorry, Riemann mapping theorem by Koibe, Japan mathematician, in Alfo's text. Some students at least have a feeling that when you write a text in mathematics, suppose I write a test in complex analysis and I give a proof of Cauchy's theorem, there is a feeling that the proof was given by me. No, I am only a catalyst, I am only an agent to convey the mathematics of Cauchy through textbook to you. So Riemann mapping theorem says that between any two domains, open connected set, simply connected open subset of C, which is not the all of C, there exists a bi-holomorphic mapping. That means a holomorphic mapping analytic function, which is inverse is also analytic, from U to open disk C. Why the condition which is not all of C? What is the sanctity of the condition which is not all of C? A function which is defined and analytic at all points of C is called
entire function.
What is the image here? Open unit disk, it's bounded.
Sir, C is not compact, but open unit disk is compact.
No, no. What is? The question is why did I put the condition that it is not all of C? Because if it is full of C, it would be entire, right?
Yes, sir. Yeah, the image is open unit disk, so the function
bounded. What will be the entire function?
Yes, sir, it becomes constant.
Constant. We are not interested in constant functions. So what Riemann mapping theorem is that any two simply connected domains are conformally equivalent. And I have a classical simply connected set in C that is open disk. So if you want to find a bi-holomorphic map from D1 to D2, I make a bypass. I first go from D1 to unit disk by Riemann mapping theorem, and this also to unit disk, and you take the composite. What you get is G inverse F. This is F, this is G. Then G inverse F will be a mapping from D1 to D2. So Riemann mapping theorem simply says that all simply connected domains are conformally equivalent. Therefore, open unit disk is equivalent to open square or open rectangle, but cannot be equivalent to an annulus, because annulus is not simply connected. So these are all different ways of looking at a simply connected domain, which is a characteristic property of an asset of complex analysis integration theory. The most well-known definition of simply connected domain is G is simply connected if and only if the complement of G in the extended complex plane is connected. That's what Alford says. If you look at Conway's book, proof of all the statements are there. But I won't advise you to make by heart this proof, because I cannot use this as a tool to check whether domain is simply connected or not. So it's a good theorem, but at the same time, bad theorem in the sense that I cannot immediately apply. So come to power series. I think it's a powerful series. So now Cuk. You know power series and convergence of power series. Power series is a series of the form sigma n x minus e raised to n. Corresponding to every power series, there exists an R called the radius of convergence, such that the power series converges for all values of mod z minus c less than r. And on r we don't know, and greater than r we don't know, but there is always what's called the disk of convergence. And the convergence is uniform on all compact subsets of the disk. Okay. By looking at the power series representation, or what is called the Laura series, or by looking at other properties of functions, we have three types of singularities for analytic functions, what's called removable, pole, and essential. I'm interested in pole because I'm interested in functions, those only singularities are poles, what are called meromorphic functions. I will not touch this point here because I want to take you to something else. But I am interested in asking a question. You know that sine z and cos z are entire functions, e raised to z. They are all entire. Their power series representation is convergent for all values of z. That's another way of looking at it. So I am asking a question. Does functions like sine, cos, etc., do they have singularities anywhere?
They have an essential singularity.
At which point?
At infinity.
Good. All that I told was that sin z and cos z, etc., do not have singular points in C. It could be point at infinity, and the nature of the singularity is that they are essential. It is essential. You cannot remove that singularity. Okay. I am pet with this property, this topic, because that was my MSc project 40 years back. Existence of functions with natural boundary. What is natural boundary? Look at the simple example. Okay, I wrote like this, I forgot to fill the symbol. 1 plus z plus z square plus etc. is a geometric series which converges to 1 by 1 minus z when mod z is less than 1. So when you start studying complex analytics and power series, immediately you put the condition that mod z is less than 1, because only when mod z less than 1, it converges to 1 by 1 minus z. But 1 by 1 minus z is defined and analytic at all points except z equal to 1. Therefore, there is a principle called analytical continuation, which allows to enlarge the domain of definition of the function, which is mod z less than 1 in this case, to the entire complex plane except z equal to 1. So that I can enlarge the domain of definition of the function, and that technique is called analytic continuation. I'm not going to the details. Now, 1 by 1 minus z is defined except for z equal to 1. And therefore, now 1 by 1 minus z, which is a limit of this geometric series, is analytic at all points except z equal to 1. And there is a theory which says that on mod z equal to r, there is at least one point which is a singularity. That is a real point. And that is the singularity here, z equal to 1. Z equal to 1 means it's a real point, x is equal to 1. Suppose every point, so there is at least one singularity in the domain of definition. If every point in the domain of definition or on the boundary becomes a singular point, there is no way out to analytically continue the function. I could analytically continue the function sigma z square because there was only one singular point, z equal to 1, and I can avoid that point, I can analytically continue. But if every point on mod z equal to 1, or for that matter on the domain of definition of the function, becomes a singular point, then analytic continuation is not possible and the boundary becomes closed, boundary becomes natural boundary. So what is the summary? Natural boundary is applied to a case of power series where analytic continuation is not possible. That is, every point becomes a singular point. And that was my MSc project under Professor Abdi. I don't want to tell stories of the viva held and all that, because you will not realize the importance of viva, because just for my viva, a professor came from Chennai, Madras to Cochin, just to conduct my viva. That to MSc. Okay. Now things are different. So my question to this is, are there functions with natural boundary? And the boundary, that is what's called gap series. I will give you one example of a gap series. The rest you can look at the internet. Look at sigma z raised to 2 raised to n. 2 raised to n. N is equal to 1 is 2. N is equal to 2 is 4. N is equal to 3 is 8, N is equal to 4 is 16, etc. So there are gaps in the powers of Z, right? Are you understanding me? Sure. Gap series means there are so many gaps in the powers of Z raised to 2 raised to N. Or forget about that, Z raised to N factorial, for example. Okay, Z raised to N factorial, what will be the powers like? 1 factorial is 1, 2 factorial? Come on.
2 into 2. 3
factorial?
24.
So many gaps are there, isn't it, in the powers? Am I right?
Yes, sir.
That's what's called gap series. What are the examples? Z raised, sigma z raised to 2 raised to n, sigma z raised to 2n, sigma 2n factorial, sigma n factorial, sorry, z raised to n factorial. They are all examples of gap series, and you can prove that all gap series have the natural boundary. So I'll take 5 minutes more and encourage discussion, because Riemann hypothesis is the hot topic today. And poor Riemann, though he passed away a couple of years ago, may be wondering that his hypothesis is solved, but nothing has happened. So Riemann theta function is theta s. S is complex, sigma plus it equal to sigma 1 by n raised to s. That is the simple, beautiful Riemann theta function. Look at the fact, s is at the power. So how does it look like? Sigma 1 by n raised to s, s is sigma plus it means complex number. So 1 by 1 raised to z plus 1 by 2 raised to z plus 1 by 3 raised to z. Initially, immediately says that it's valid for real part of z greater than 1, that is beyond the horizontal strip, real part of z greater than 1, that is x greater than 1. What Riemann hypothesis says is that Riemann theta function has its zeros only at the negative even integers. They are what is called the trivial zeros. What is zero? Zero of a function means root of the function, where the points where the function vanishes. So Riemann function theta function has zeros only at the negative even integers, and complex numbers with real part is equal to half. That is, all complex numbers sigma plus it where real part is half. That's what's called the critical strip. That was listed as the 8th problem of Hilbert in 1900, and after 100 years nothing happened. And it's also in the list of Millennium Prize problem. Therefore, whoever who says that Riemann hypothesis is proved by him, make a note of it. Very, very, very less chance. I don't underestimate the power of technology and the intelligence of mathematicians nowadays, but a very, very remote chance. But surprise can occur, like people, what happened to Andrew Wiles when he proved Fermat's last theorem, which was 350 years old. This is what's called the critical strip. So all the non-trivial zeros of Riemann's function lies in this strip. Real part of z equal to half, straight line. Don't worry, those who want to solve Riemann hypothesis, don't get dejected. It is still open. But that has been checked for the first that much solutions. A proof that is true for every interesting solution would shed light of many of the mysteries surrounding the distribution of prime numbers. So complex analysis gets connected to number theory, that to hardcore number theory of distribution of primes through the Riemann hypothesis. I will take 2 minutes to explain how complex analysis get connected to fractal theory using theory of meromorphic functions, that is functions having only poles are, sorry, only singularities are poles. Okay, there is a joke which says that there is a standard covering letter by Professor Edmond Landau. Whenever he received a proof of Fermat's last theorem, "Dear sir, your proof of Fermat's last theorem has been received. The first mistake is on page number, etc., etc., and line number, etc., etc." What does it mean? During the Landau's time, they never expected a proof of Fermat's last theorem. Okay. And there is a strong connection between Ramanujan and Riemann. Ramanujan has proved that 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus etc. up to infinity is negative 1 by 12. No chance, isn't it? But the same mistake was done by many, many other mathematicians. Therefore, Hardy knew that Ramanujan is going to be great. The mistake that he made was he applied the zeta function to minus 1, and zeta of minus 1 is 1 by 1 by 1 plus 1 by 1 by 2, that is 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4, etc. And he wrongly applied the formula for zeta function at minus 1, because I told you that convergence takes place only for real part of z greater than 1. And he got the wrong answer, that the sum of the infinite series of positive numbers is negative 1 by 10. So I'm going to conclude. What has this to do with fractals, theory of fractal? So what is a fractal? What Galileo told was that the entire world is, nature is full of mathematics, and there are only shapes like triangles, circles, and geometric figures. That was proved wrong by a great man called Mandelbrot. So with the Euclidean and Galilean tools, you cannot find the length of a coastal line, because coastal line is not a Galilean object, it's a fractal. Fractal means, comes from the word fractus, means broken. So you cannot measure the length of a coastal line. Let me ask a quiz question. Which is the country with maximum coastal line? Coastal area? Country? Which country has the longest?
Canada.
Good, Canada. Okay, fine. So that gave birth to Mandelbrot set, and look at the profile of Mandelbrot. I was fortunate to shake hands with Mandelbrot in 2006 in ICM, where? Madrid, Spain. Can Vinod Kumar and Vijayamohan give a job to such a person? Where will he appoint? Economics department, engineering, physiology, medicine, or computer science, or physics, or mathematics? Wonderful, isn't it? What do you feel about this? Supermarket. You get everything. So he was professor of economics in Harvard, professor of engineering in Yale, medicine and physiology in Einstein School of Medicine. He was in Thomas Watson Center, Computer Center, and he got Wolf Prize in physics. And he's a celebrated mathematician. So you may wonder, what is the common between economics, engineering, and all these things? And that is nothing but the theory of fractals, or chaos theory. You can get a fractal or Mandelbrot set through iterations of rational functions also. That is the most exciting application of complex analysis. You take a rational function, for example, Mobius transformation, AZ plus B by CZ plus D, and keep on iterating this. What does it mean? What's a rational function? It's a function of the form PZ by QZ, PNQR polynomials with Q not equal to zero, right? So singular points of RZ will be only the zeros of QZ, therefore only poles, therefore it's basically a meromorphic function. That is, quotient of two rational analytic function is meromorphic. Okay. To take with the point Z naught and apply rational functions iteratively, you can ask some simple questions like, does this sequence of iterations converge? For what choices of initial point the convergence takes place? There is a small change in the initial point, what's called butterfly effect. This is the basic principle of meteorology, butterfly effect. There is a small change in the initial point, what will happen because of the nonlinear dynamics or iterations, the rate goes, isn't it? So there is a beautiful book, Complex Dynamics and Iterations of Rational Functions, those who are interested in theory of Julia and fractal sets. And Mandelbrot set is an example of a Julia set. Fractal sets and Julia sets are in some sense complementary to each other. Such sets exist in nature just like fractals exist in nature. And that is what's called the complex dynamics. Whereas fractal set is regular in the sense that it is decent, Julia set is chaotic, they fill the entire complex plane. So this is an example of a Julia set. Okay. I don't want to technically define what is a Mandelbrot set. All these, it is now called a classical Mandelbrot set because there are some other Mandelbrot sets also coming up as a generalization of the classical Mandelbrot set. And fine. So, okay. There is a statement by a great mathematician. The mathematician is, Ronald Graham. It says that any mathematics talk, okay, any mathematics talk should have a proof of a theorem and a joke, and they should not be the same. Did you understand the joke of it? Any good talk in mathematics should have a theorem and its proof. A proof of a theorem and a joke, and the proof should not be a joke, right? So I want to conclude that this talk, though I told sort of jokes, I never gave you a proof of a theorem, and I never wrote a theorem. Of course, I wrote Cauchy's theorem and so on. I never discussed the proof. So my last theorem is this. What is that theorem? Read out, please. What is the theorem?
Mathematics is exciting and beautiful.
Proof is?
Obvious.
Obvious. That's what I did for the last 2 hours. So to conclude is, no mathematical subject is in isolation. You can connect complex analysis, which is continuous mathematics, with number theory, which is discrete via Riemann hypothesis. And connect complex analysis with theory of fractals, Julia sets, Plato sets, and all these wonderful complex dynamics via theory of meromorphic functions, that is functions whose only singular points are poles. And that is what is happening. So don't say that I like complex analysis, but I don't like number theory. They are all part of the same ocean. Beautiful mathematics that is flowing from 20,000 years ago. Yeah, there are plenty of books by Indian authors also in complex analysis by Ponnuswamy, Karunakaran, Arumugam, and etc. John Conway, Complex Analysis. Sergey Lang, Complex Analysis. Rammert is a very good book. I think we have changed Alford's book to Rammert book from this batch onwards. I don't remember. Okay. And this book I recommend, 100 Reasons to be a Scientist, is downloadable. Actually, this is a book which I suggest to all lovers of science because it is the remarks of 100 scientists. What did they achieve by becoming a scientist? Okay, so 100 Reasons to be a Scientist is downloadable, and you are an expert in downloading than me. So thank you very much. So my advice to you is try to be a good human being. Quote is, I asked a wise man, tell me, sir, in which field could I make a great career? He said with a smile, be a good human being. There is a huge opportunity in this area because there is little competition. Isn't it? Excellent quote for young boys and girls. I wish you the very best in life. There are some models, role models like this. You can become your own role model. Your role model could be your teacher or somebody. And I hope that you can identify these people. Shall we spend 1 minute?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Who is this?
Dr. Amartya
Amritya Singh.
Who is this?
Radhakrishnan.
Yeah, this is Radhakrishnan. Who is this?
Raghunath Mashelkar.
Rao.
Jayant Narayikar.
Narayikar, correct. This is, you know, Virat Kohli.
Sachin Tendulkar.
Who is this?
Sam Alex Shaw.
Very good. You know this gentleman, no doubt.
Einstein.
Albert Einstein.
Vikram sir.
PC Mahalanobis.
No, no, that's fine.
PC Mahalanobis.
Anybody from Calcutta?
Yes, sir, I am from Bengal.
Bengal. Mahalanobis.
ISI Kolkata, founder of ISI Kolkata.
Correct. This is a great singer, Rishidas, Mother Teresa. This is former commissioner of election commission of this session. And these are two Keralite IAS officers, excellent. So I will conclude with the social message of using soap, mask and social distancing to become, make break change. There is no way out. If you want to come to Kerala and attend an offline meeting, you have to remove this and this pandemic. So thank you all. Wish you a happy Onam. Welcome to Kerala. Yes, questions are welcome. Any doubts, clarifications?
Yes.
I can spend another 15 minutes.
Thanks a lot, sir, for this fruitful session. I feel.
Okay.
Yes. Thanks a lot, sir. The session was quite fruitful. Now I encourage the students to ask their doubts. Before doing that, please switch on your video camera and introduce yourself by telling your name and the institution.
Okay, my name is Hong. West Bengal and I'm in Vishwabharati University. Founded by
Rabindranath. Oh, good.
Actually, I have question, sir. When a complex map maps a closed set to a closed set?
Pardon? Where does the complex map?
Maps the closed set into closed sets.
Oh, there are plenty of maps which maps a interior of a circle to interior of an ellipse. I think Z plus 1 by Z.
Sir, is there any formula to determine whether the map is closed map or not?
Oh, no, that no, is... absolutely no, absolutely no. It's very difficult. See, I said simply that any two domains are conformally equivalent. That doesn't mean that for any two domains I can find the map. It's an existence theorem. It's not easy. It's not easy to find. I give you any two domains, I cannot simply find a function. But there are some techniques like Mobius transformation which will help you. That's all.
Sir, in open mapping theorem, we take that f dash z is not equal to zero. Sir, in any such simple formulas or so that we can
check? Yeah, open mapping theorem says that every analytic function is an open map. But if you want to construct that map, that's the point.
Yes, sir.
If you want to construct that map, it's not going to be easy. Given any two open domains. That's what I told. Exist. Suppose you are smart and ask me, give me an answer. Example, I cannot do that. But from standard domains I have. That's what I told you. Interior of a circle to interior of an ellipse, including the boundary. The mapping is Z plus 1 by Z. What's called Aeroflow function or Shukov's function, something like that. Yes, there is Ramesh Babu, please. Ramesh Babu, please introduce and then ask. Okay, Rabika Gurung, please unmute and ask.
Good afternoon, sir. Thank you for your session. I just wanted to ask this question, that if someone is interested in complex analysis, but hasn't been able to narrow down to a topic of research, like what would your suggestion be? How should one approach their interest of topic?
Yeah, I admit in the beginning itself that I loved complex analysis, but I couldn't marry. Right? In the sense that I am not a researcher in complex analysis, but I still love teaching complex analysis. If I am given an option to teach my subject now, graph theory and complex analysis, I will definitely teach complex analysis. Okay. So best place is in complex dynamics, that is fractals theory. There is one Dr. Vinod Kumar, not this Vinod Kumar, another Vinod Kumar from Rajagiri School in Kerala, Rajagiri School of Engineering and Technology, who has done a lot of research in fractal geometry, complex dynamics, etc. So if you want to communicate with me and get more details about these things, I am typing my email ID. You are free to contact me. And complex dynamics research is going on in Cochin. Another place is Jammu University. Another is IIT Kanpur, IIT Chennai, where Professor Ponnusamy is the president of the Ramanujan Mathematical Society, and he is a complex analyst.
Okay.
If you are interested in complex dynamics, I will definitely suggest Dr. Vinod Kumar of Rajagiri School in Cochin.
Okay.
Fine.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yes, Vinay Singh.
Thank you, sir. Sir, I am assistant professor in NIT Mizoram.
Gujarat.
Hello.
NIT Mizoram.
Please
North
turn
East.
On your camera, video camera.
NIT Mizoram, Northeast.
Oh, very good. Okay.
Oh. And I'm here as a mathematics professor. I want one question, sir.
Yes.
I'm teaching complex analysis. I think in real analysis, integration is if y barabar fx, we can integrate some substitution, then we will get easily integrate that function. I can find that type of problem in the complex analysis. If we can put z equal to some other function of a complex variable, then that whole integration becomes a simple integration. This is like in real integration.
Yes, that's possible.
That's possible. But I search many books, but I cannot find that type of example.
Okay.
You understand my question? My English is very poor. I can explain in Hindi. You can understand.
Yes.
सर जब जो फंक्शन हम लोग नहीं करते, जैसे आईआईटीजी में क्वेश्चन पूछता है कि इंटीग्रेशन का, तो कुछ उसमें हमने पुट कर दिया x बराबर 1 बाय t, तो dt में इंटीग्रेशन बहुत इजी हो जाता है.
ठीक.
तो उस वहां पे dx इक्वल टू 1 बाय माइनस 1 बाय t स्क्वायर dt कर देते हैं. उसी तरह मैं कॉम्प्लेक्स में एक ऐसा एग्जाम्पल ढूंढना चाह रहा हूँ कि अगर फंक्शन कॉम्प्लेक्स में है, जेड में है, dz में है, तो जेड को हम डब्ल्यू में शिफ्ट कर दें, डब्ल्यू प्लेन में. जैसे आपने अभी जीरो वन और थ्री को इन्फिनिटी को मैप किया था, उस डब्ल्यू को जेड से मैं रिलेट करूं और डी डब्ल्यू में कन्वर्ट कर दूं सारे इंटीग्रेशन को. तो इस तरह कोई एग्जाम्पल मुझे किसी बुक में मिला नहीं. सब वही कर रहे हैं जो हर बुक में, कि आप कॉम्प्लेक्स को आपने उसके कंटूर इंटीग्रेशन से रिप्लेस किया, मगर डी जेड वाला कॉन्सेप्ट किसी ने अप्लाई नहीं किया.
Okay.
ये मेरा क्वेश्चन आप समझ में है सर?
Yeah, I understood.
इस तरह कोई क्वेश्चन किसी बुक में नहीं है. मैंने सारी बुक जो आपने दिखाया, उस सारी बुक मैंने पढ़ी है, किसी में नहीं मिला मुझे इस तरह का एग्जांपल. जो हम लोग एनालिसिस में करते हैं इंटीग्रेशन, जो सिंपल जो हम लोग क्लास 12 में पढ़ते हैं, उस तरह का एग्जांपल मुझे कॉम्प्लेक्स प्लेन में चाहिए.
ओके.
वो मेरे दिमाग में बहुत पहले से है. एक बस यही मैं आपसे बस यही एग्जांपल चाहिए था, क्योंकि बाकी हर तरह के जो प्रॉब्लम्स हैं वो हर बुक्स में हैं, स्टैंडर्ड सारी बुक्स.
As you said, there are different techniques of integration for solving problems in the jam and all that.
No. I am asking for only the transformation method. In the class 12 and 11, we will introduce the transformation method, na? If integration is very hard in the fx, you can transform in t function.
Fine.
And you can get very easily solution. So that you remember that process, x equal to ft, then dx is equal to f dash t dt. We can that concept use in the complex also or not? This is my simple question.
Okay, fine.
If w, just as for example, w you mapping in z, so z is mapping in w, so our function is fz dz, so we can replace dz as a dw, then w whole integration becomes in w plane, then w that function fw dw is become easily or not. If we can हम लोग ये कर सकते हैं कि नहीं, वी कैन दिस प्रोसेस और नॉट? इस टाइप का एग्जांपल मुझे किसी को नहीं मिला. सब उसी तरह करते हैं कि आप जेड को एक्स प्लस आई वाई रखो, वो करो. सारी बुक्स में यही लिखा हुआ है. फिर आप कॉम्प्लेक्स इंटीग्रेशन रेसिड्यू के थ्योरम को देखिए, उसमें भी वही कर रहा है, मगर इस तरह के मेथड से नहीं कर रहा है, सब्स्टिट्यूशन मेथड से नहीं कर रहा है.
ओके ओके, an email with respect to this point, I can get back to you.
Okay, okay.
Today, Sunday, you please spend time with your son.
Yes, yes. Because this is a pandemic nice situation. Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
Sir, agar is tarah ka koi example mile to mujhe send kariyega.
Theek, theek. Anybody else?
Sir,
let me.
Yes.
Sir, actually, I am Fonku again. Sir, actually, in something related with the line integration of vector calculus. So it is slightly different with the integration of real analysis. There is some sense of
you are not audible. Your voice is breaking. Your voice is breaking. You please send an email. That'll be better. Anybody else?
Sir, let me ask one question.
Okay, please.
Thank you for your wonderful session. And see, sir, in real case, we need only, while taking limits and all that, we need only to worry about two limits.
Yes.
But in complex, we have infinitely many choices.
Yes.
But still, in experiences, the complex situation is more easier in many cases. Why it is happening?
I don't know, because that may be a personal taste. Because your Cauchy-Riemann equation comes into help for integration, especially in the case of analytic functions.
In many real integration problems will become more easier when it is being converted into complex integrals.
Yeah, evaluation of definite integral using Cauchy's residue theorem, especially Cauchy principal value and that at minus infinity to infinity, some sine t by t, it's not easy. Okay, this is a classic question, 0 to infinity sin t by t, that you have to apply the what is called residue theorem, real part, imagined part, etc. So some of the real definite integral can be transformed into complex integral and use residue theorem. What is this correct?
People usually think that while we are having infinitely many paths and that taking limit will become very difficult, yeah. But the situation is entirely different in many
cases. That's what Cauchy is great.
Thank you, sir. Others can ask questions now, please.
Is my friends Anne Marie and Gia and all are they here? Yeah, Shravan Kumar, please. Vinod Kumar, somebody is asking for feedback link. I don't know.
Sir, we are not providing any feedback link, but they can directly WhatsApp their feedback to my number.
Okay, okay.
Or you can or they can express it here itself.
Vinod sir, can you send this PDF file also? Sir, PDF so file.
We will share the recorded video in a YouTube in our YouTube channel.
Somebody else wanted to ask question. Okay, Anne Mary has put the link. Namrata, where are you from?
I'm from Udupi, sir, Karnataka.
Which college?
Manipal Institute of Technology.
Oh, MIT. Okay, okay.
Yeah. Is there?
You are a second year student?
Yeah, yeah, sir. Second year.
MSc or BSc?
Yeah, no, MSc.
Okay, fine.
Namrata, you can ask participants to interact if there anyone.
Is there any more further doubts? Sir, could you please share your email ID?
I want to return bambart@gmail.com.
Yeah.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes.
Sir, please repeat your email ID.
I have written in the chat box. vambart@gmail.com.
Okay, sir, I got it. Sir, one thing, sir, I want to ask you, sir, if please suggest some books on for preparing CSIR, UGC NET and graduate aptitude test for engineering in mathematics for context analysis.
I am not an expert for that. Vinod, can you please help them?
Of course, there are many books, good textbooks, and also you can go through the previous questions that will be more useful in respect of the competitive exams. Of course, there are many good textbooks. Many of them are available to download in internet. And those who are seriously preparing for NET and other competitive exams, they can join with us. Our platform, Math Aspirants WhatsApp groups, will be a good discussion platform of students, those who are preparing for this type of competitive exams from all over India. If anyone wish to join with us, you can WhatsApp me in the number that is shared in the chat box. Okay, sometimes BSc students may be not able to follow the entire thing, but they can, if they have, they can express their feeling if they want. No need to worry, all these things you will study in your PG courses and higher studies.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, yes.
I am Hiba Muhammad from PSMO College, Tirunelveli, Malappuram, Kerala. So this topic was quite alien topic for me because I haven't studied it yet.
Okay.
But I promise you, sir, after studying that I'll watch this video again in this YouTube channel because it was such a good talk and I'm more interested in complex analysis and I'll be watching it later and try to answer all these questions. And your session was too good, sir. And we'll be expecting more sessions from you. Thank you, sir.
Okay, there's one, somebody else asking, Devdutt. I saw some other raise hand.
So I would like to call Dr. Vijayamohan R, who is a professor of Mahatma Gandhi College, Irati, Kerala, who has given the technical assistance to speak a few words. So please carry on.
Thank you, Namrata. Happy Independence Day wishes to each and everyone.
Thank you.
I am very happy to be part of this program because we are here and we also got an opportunity to listen very interesting, informative and motivating lecture by eminent mathematician and great teacher, Professor Ambat Vijayakumar. And also I am very happy that he is a very, very kind man who are that much interested to learn mathematics. And I request the participants who are interested to learn great things, be in contact with him continuously, because for many, so many years, he was the organizer of Mathematics Olympia, and he was the organizer in the Kerala area. And for the last 2 hours, we really enjoyed his class. And also, he is the advisor of all our programs. We all know that this program is conducted on behalf of Maths Aspirants WhatsApp group. And Dr. Vinod Kumar, sir, is the main leader of this program. And he always gets the advice from Professor Ambat Vijayakumar, sir. Actually, we are going through the path created by Professor Ambat Vijayakumar, sir. And his advice is very much valuable. And his support and his presence in various programs that we are conducted for the last several years. His presence is also an encouragement to all of us. Last year, on the last Independence Day, we had a lecture by Professor Abhijit Adhikari from Presidency University, Kolkata. And that was the first lecture that we conducted to all over the India. Today, we know that most of the participants, not only from Kerala, but from various parts of the country. And among the participants, there were faculty members, eminent mathematicians, researchers, and students. And all of them interacted in this session in a very, very fruitful way. And I thank you, Professor Ambat Vijayakumar, sir, and also expect your cooperation, advice, and guidance throughout our program. And also, sir, and also I am very thankful to all our participants who spend their valuable time here and over through Namrata. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, sir. So it is finally time to conclude this program. And I would like to call Amrita Varier of St. Joseph College, Devagiri, Calicut, Kerala, to give the vote of thanks. Over to you, Amrita.
Thank you, Ms. Namrata. Thank you so much. Good afternoon, all of you. And I wish you a happy Independence Day. And in this day where we remember all our freedom fighters who fought for our independence and freedom, I will proudly say that mathematics is a subject which gives us immense freedom. The freedom to choose, the freedom to think, the freedom to write, especially real analysis and complex analysis. And yes, it has been said that the essence of mathematics lies in its freedom. Let me begin with thanking Dr. Vinod Kumar, sir, Assistant Professor, TMG College, Tirur, Kerala, and Dr. Bijumon sir, Associate Professor at MG College, Irati, Kannur, Kerala. Complex analysis is always known as a topic which is a little complex for all of us, but it has been made into a rather simpler one by Dr. Ambat Vijayakumar sir, Emeritus Professor, Cochin University, and Vice President of Ramanujan Mathematical Society. Thank you so much, sir. The way you described about your first love was really nice. It was really nice telling that your first love was complex analysis. And more than you told about the beauty of complex analysis, you told about the beauty of mathematics. And also, you told so many inspirational words about from Rabindranath Tagore and APJ Abdul Kalam and Swami Vivekananda. As Hiba told before, complex analysis, as I'm a third year student, it's a little alien topic for third year students, but I'll also listen to it after I've studied all the topics. And thank you so much. It was a nice rendezvous with you, sir. Thank you so much for spending such valuable time, 2.5 hours with us. And then I would like to thank Ms. Sukala Srihari of Pondicherry University and Ms. Suyatnya Srihari of Brennan College for their beautiful prayer. And Ms. Namrata N. from Manipal Institute of Technology for her well coordination in the best possible manner. And along with that, I would like to thank Ms. Gia Rose Johnson, a research scholar at IIT Madras, and Anne Mary Journey, a research scholar at Cochin University, for their support throughout this session. And last but not the least, I would like to thank the Math Aspirants Group, the reason for which we are here right now, the reason for which many before us reached high positions, and the reason for which we started aiming high. And finally, the reason for which we started loving mathematics to its core. Thank you. Thank you all. And also, I wish all of you an advanced happy honor. Thank you.
G.
जनगणमन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विदाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल बंगाल विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलति तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मागे गाहे तव जय गादा जनगण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विदादा जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे